Welcome back to our studio. I'm Jeffrey Brown, and I'm joined now by Marlon James, who's talking about his new novel, A Brief History of Seven Killings, a sprawling, multi-voiced sort of epic of a particular place and time. The time is Jamaica, the 70s, a place you knew.
I knew, well, kind of. I was 6 years old in 1976. So my mother has to take the credit. She was a police detective, so nothing
went
past her. Yeah, at one point, both of my parents were cops.
Yeah.
And my dad went on to become a lawyer, and my mom, you know, was a detective. She rose to the rank of inspector. And so a lot of what I know from the 70s is me knowing what she knows.
Really? So, I mean, she's, and that means knowing life on the street, crime.
Yeah, crime and just what was going on. Because when you're six, no matter how bad it is, you still have a six-year-old's view of the world.
Yeah.
And to me, it was a world of wonder. It's like, even knowing the number of finding out in hindsight, the number of times her life was at risk and so on, is really kind of eye-opening.
Well, I mean, a time of wonder for you as a child, but in Jamaica in the 70s, a time of tremendous turbulence.
Oh,
right?
it may have been the most turbulent time we've ever had, especially that year.
Yeah.
We had curfews. You know, there was a lot of political violence. It was an election year. There is all a fuss about the CIA and Cuba, so we entered the Cold War. And at the same time, it was an explosion of creativity. Reggae had finally hit the Billboard top 10.
Yeah.
And there was still so much of it coming up. So it's almost as if all this amazing, astonishing negative energy and positive energy was at war with itself.
Yeah, and for you as a writer later on, I mean, is this something you knew you always wanted to write about? Because this is a tremendous material, at least.
I always knew it. I didn't know it was something I wanted to write about.
Yeah.
Because, again, I certainly with me, every book that I write, I start off being afraid of it. Afraid of the story, that I'm not the person to write this.
Wait a minute, afraid of, like, writing the novel? Or
yeah.
Afraid of the particular story that
afraid
you're grappling
with? Afraid of the particular
with.
Story, even that my previous novels and the one before. And I have, the first thing is just coming to terms with the idea that I can do it. And even if I fail, it would be a pretty decent failure or something.
That it's worth the effort.
Yeah. And sometimes I don't know that until I'm midway in writing a book. And certainly something like this, which has so many characters and starts with such a violent part of Jamaica's history and then goes all the way to 1991.
Yeah. This one, I mean, the plot revolves in part around an assassination attempt on Bob Marley.
Yes.
A very famous and very real character, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you, as I gather, you didn't want it. It's not about Bob Marley, right? So here you have this larger-than-life figure, and he's hovering throughout the novel. You didn't want it to be only about him.
Funny enough, I wanted it to be as accurate to. Funny enough, this was in a lot of ways. If you are a Jamaican, if you are not Bob Marley, this is your view of him.
Yeah.
And I wanted that view actually. I wanted because he's already an icon. He was already a symbol. He was more defined by then by what he meant to people as opposed to who he was actually. And I wasn't necessarily interested in uncovering the nuts and bolts real Bob Marley. I wanted him as he's defined by other people. And it's not always positive. Not even by, even some Jamaicans absolutely hated him and hated what he stood for. And I was really fascinated by that. The Bob Marley I knew, which is the Bob Marley the icon, the Bob Marley the dinner table argument, the Bob Marley the star and sex symbol, and what does all that mean if you are not him?
So you had all these views of Bob Marley, and that gave you all these voices from the street on to all kinds of, and you chose to write it in those different, I mean, through those different eyes.
Yeah. I was more interested in how other people saw him, and some of the people in the book don't even know him and have never met him.
Yeah.
But because of this event, the event actually has these sort of tentacles that stretch out and grab them. And one of the characters is a woman who is just basically watching him from across the street, hoping that he'll notice her, but she gets embroiled in it. And her, the consequences for her go on for two decades. And I was really interested in a very big way in the way in which events, even private events, have really big consequences. And part of that comes from reading a lot of Victorian novels.
Reading Victorian novels?
Yeah, big Dickens and Trollope and George Eliot. Yeah. These really big canvas novels that actually sometimes start from very small things.
Right.
And I was really interested in that sort of, how does that small thing become a big event, an international event? And this was a kind of the perfect case.
And in a way, tell us about a whole time and era. I mean, you think of Charles Dickens, and we might think of a particular character in one of those novels, but it becomes a sprawling novel that tells us something about London at the time.
I think it's Trollope has that novel, The Way We Live Now, and that could be the subtitle for any good novel, I think.
Yeah.
And that's what I was ultimately interested in. So Marley becomes sort of this trigger, this pivot.
Yeah.
And which things spin, most often spin out of control. But that's what really fascinated me.
This idea of history somehow I don't know if it's politics or history and culture, that you want to write about those things somehow, but through a story.
Yeah, and to an extent, I actually didn't want to write about that. In many ways, one of my characters, Nina Burgess, is close to me when she says, I hate politics and I hate that I have to know.
Yeah.
And that was kind of me as well. I certainly didn't set out to write a novel about the Cold War and about politics and the CIA and Henry Kissinger. But if you're going to touch on an event, you have to sort of run after all the strands that you see in front of you. And that's what happened. It's a novel about an assassination attempt that, because of what it is, turns into a political novel. And sometimes it even turns into a spy novel, which is great on one hand for a writer, but it also means you end up with a 700-page book.
Exactly, yeah. But it also means that you're writing in different voices and the use of language. So you have various Jamaican dialects.
Yeah.
Tell me about language and how, because you had to play with it, you had to use it here, not there.
Yeah, I realized really pretty early on from writing this book that it would be a book I threw to the characters.
Yeah.
And let them tell the story. Mm-hmm. And then I, of course, became obsessed with getting characters right. You know, a right-wing conservative CIA guy won't sound like a Rolling Stone journalist. So it's not just the Jamaican accent, it's also the American accent.
Right.
Jamaican accent in 1976 wouldn't sound that way in 1996. Mm-hmm. And so I had to get that right if I'm going to throw the novel to the cast. And that's what happened. That's why it became this sort of parade of voices. Because if I'm going to throw it to them, then they have to sound authentic, or at least close to them. Mm-hmm.
So it's a 700-page epic, in a sense. It doesn't sound like you started off thinking that that's what you were doing.
Not at all.
Yeah.
I started off writing a hard-boiled crime fiction book.
Uh-huh.
The very first word, the very first sentence that I wrote in this book is now on page 470.
Really?
Yeah. Because I started off with this Chicago hitman with romance issues who has a mission to kill a Jamaican who's somehow connected to the assassination attempt. And I just kept running into dead ends, making it these one-person novellas, until a friend of mine, who's no longer with us, she said, you know, this is one novel, right?
Yeah,
so I can't take the credit
for
it.
But you almost had like two or three novels ahead of where you had started, right?
And she's the one who saw the common thread, my friend Rachel. I didn't see it, but then it became that.
Yeah. Let me just, in our last few minutes, just to broaden out a little bit, because one of the things about a book fair is you get to talk to a lot of writers and look at a lot of different genres of writing. And I'm wondering about the writing that's coming out of the Caribbean today,
right.
Jamaica, the larger Caribbean. Is it a thriving scene, literature? Mm-hmm. Is it changing today?
It's absolutely thriving, not just on here, but also across the Atlantic. Poetry has been, breaking whole new grounds. There's a whole new generation of fiction writers, a lot of them from Jamaica. Mm-hmm. And even the established ones are doing some of their very best work now, Eddie Gidantica and Juno Diaz. But, you know, we also have writers like Kai Miller and Roland Watson Grant and writers who are challenging the ideas of story, doing even more brave things with language than I'm doing.
Yeah.
And even wrestling with the whole idea of what's a novel, what's Caribbean, and what stories should we tell?
Well, what stories to tell? Because I've talked to Edwidge and Juno and others about this, because in an age of globalization, you know, where everybody sort of grows up in some ways with some of the same cultural references, how do you maintain, or do you want to maintain, a sense of place and you know, a special place?
Yes and no.
Yeah.
And I think I can speak for a lot of writers of my generation that is the same thing. We are, of course, bound by place, and because it's what we know, and we're Jamaican and we're Trinidadian and so on. But we also sort of claim the right to write about anything. Yeah. Roland Watson Grant's novel is set in Louisiana, and it's not Jamaicans in Louisiana, they're Americans. And the stuff I'm writing next is fantasy. So,
oh, is that right?
Yeah. So, ultimately, that was the great thing about being in the Caribbean and being now is recognizing the freedom to even go beyond the Caribbean story.
Yeah.
And that's what I think we're taking claim of.
And you yourself, I understand, teach at McAllister College and live in
Minnesota,
right?
For 7 years. So, yeah.
No, so that's a little far away from that.
It's a little far away, but unfortunately, it means I can no longer bear heat, which is sad for a Caribbean person.
All right, the book is A Brief History of Seven Killings. Marlon James, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
Okay.